Everybody said, amen. Good morning, everybody. How am I today? And you too? The Lord bless everyone today in Jesus' name. Let's close our eyes for prayer. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you at this time. We bless your name because we know you are a great God, a mighty God, a powerful God. And we know you are going to bless your people. We're praying, Lord, that you pour down your blessing upon everyone this morning in Jesus' name. Let the power and the fire of the Holy Ghost burn every chaff out of every life. And any sin that our Father, Heavenly Father, has not planted, approach you this morning in Jesus' name. In every life, be mighty. In every life, shine forth. In every life, do great things in Jesus' name. And we pray that everyone will sense and feel and receive the power of the Holy Ghost today. In Jesus' mighty name, I pray. We're looking at Matthew chapter 3. Matthew chapter 3. And I'm reading from verse 11. Matthew 3, verse 11. I indeed baptize you with water unto repentance. But he that cometh after me is mightier than I, whose shoes I am not worthy to bear. He shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire. Here is John the Baptist, John the Baptizer, talking to the people. And he's talking about the one coming, talking about Jesus Christ. He uses one word twice, the word baptize. He said, I baptize you. He said, I indeed baptize you. I truly baptize you. I verily baptize you. I certainly, as you know, I baptize you. But I baptize you with water. How did he do that? He plunged them into the river. He immersed them into the water. And he said, that is what I've been doing. I do that unto repentance. I do that because you repent. And then I dip you inside the water there, and I bury your past. I lift you up. I bring a new resurrection life in you. But he said, he used that word again. The second time, baptized. He said, now I'm talking about another baptism. And that baptism, that's not what I'm going to do. There is one mightier than I. Higher than I, greater than I. There is one that is more powerful than I. He shall baptize you. The same word. He will immerse you. He will dip you into another river. It's a river of the Holy Ghost. He said, he shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost. Not only that, and with fire. I pass you through the water. He will pass through you through the fire. And when you pass through the water, you become refreshed. Dryness is gone. And it appears that there is a freshness as you are coming out of the water. But when you pass through the fire, everything that cannot stand the taste of power or the state of fire, everything will be burnt away. The Lord will baptize you. And all that chaff in your life, everything will be burnt off in Jesus' name. Look at verse 12. Whose fan is in the sand, and he will thoroughly purge his floor and gather his wheat into the garner. But he shall burn the chaff with unquenchable fire. There, John made the people to look forward to the time when Jesus Christ himself will baptize with the Holy Ghost and with fire. That clears up a lot of things. It is not man that baptizes you in the Holy Ghost. A man will baptize you in water, like John the Baptist, but someone greater, someone mightier, someone more powerful, and someone coming from all eternity. He is the one that baptizes with the Holy Ghost and with fire. John chapter 16. In John chapter 16, I'm reading here from verse 7. John 16, reading from verse 7. Jesus Christ is now introducing the subject. The subject of the power of the Holy Ghost. Chapter 16, verse 7. Nevertheless, I tell you the truth. It is expedient for you that I go away. They didn't think like that. It's profitable for you that I go away. In fact, it is necessary for you that I go away. And you're going to receive something greater, something mightier, something more powerful when I go away. As they have seen him, he's been with them. A lot of things had happened. They were saved. He prayed for them. The storm calmed. He prayed for the sick. The sick became healed. He taught them and revealed deep mysteries of the kingdom to them. And now he's saying a new era will come. A new dispensation will come. And it is expedient for you that I go away to heaven. Look at this. For then he goes, it says, for if I go not away, the Comforter will not come unto you. But if I depart, I will send him, not it, him. The Holy Ghost is a personality, is a third person in the Trinity. It says, I will send him unto you. Verse 12. I have yet many things to say unto you, but ye cannot receive them now. Howbeit, when he, that's the Holy Ghost again, he, not it, personality, when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you into all truth. For he shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak, and he will show you things to come. Acts chapter 1. In Acts chapter 1, verse 4, and being assembled together with them. Now, all that we have read about took place in the lifetime of Christ when he was here on earth. Now, he's been nailed to the cross. Now, he has died. Now, he's buried. Now, he spent 3 days in the grave. Then, he came out in the power, by the power of the Holy Ghost. He has been raised up and he appeared to his own disciples. He's been with them now for about 40 days after that resurrection. And now he was gathered with them, being assembled together with them. He commanded them that they should not depart from Jerusalem, but wait for the promise of the Father. This is not just what John the Baptist is promising. It is not only what Jesus, our Lord and Savior, has promised. It's the promise of the Father, which says he, ye have heard of me. For John truly baptized with water. John certainly immersed in water. John definitely plunged the people in water after they have repented. But ye shall be baptized, plunged into, immersed into, dipped into the Holy Ghost, not many days hence. What will happen then? When you are baptized in the Holy Ghost, verse 8, but ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost is come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me, both in Jerusalem, and in all Judea, and in Samaria, and unto the uttermost part of the earth. It says, he will do it himself. He will do it for you. Are you there? I said, he will do it for you. Empowered by the indwelling spirit. Empowered by the the indwelling spirit. We're looking at three things. Number one, the promise. Number two, the presence. Number three, the power. Number one, the promise of the Spirit. He has promised us he's going to send the Holy Ghost. The promise. Number two, the presence of the Spirit. He will dwell in you. And then it will be like fire to burn chaff out of your life. The presence of the Spirit. Number three, the power of the Spirit. The promise, the presence, the power of the Spirit. Number one, the promise of the Spirit. This is not something new that started at the time of John the Baptist. As we go to the Old Testament, the Old Testament people were told to look forward to the time when the Holy Ghost will come and come within them and upon them. Joel chapter 2. Joel chapter 2. Reading from verse 28. And it shall come to pass afterward. Notice that word, afterward. Something else would have happened. It shall come to pass afterward. After what? After Jesus would have come. After Jesus would have come to this world. After Jesus would have provided for salvation. After Jesus would have interceded for sanctification. After Jesus would have risen up. After Jesus would have gone glorified to heaven. It shall come to pass afterward. After what? After we're saved. It shall come to pass afterward. After a regenerating work has been done in your heart, in your life. And it shall come to pass afterward. After what? After he has renewed your life. After he has made you holy. After he has sanctified you. It shall come to pass afterward. Afterward. After what? After the old covenant has passed away. And then a new covenant has come in. Effected by the blood of Jesus. Verse 28, and it shall come to pass afterward that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh in the new covenant, all flesh who have tasted what happened before the afterward, all flesh saved, all flesh whose heart have been prepared by holiness because it's the Holy Ghost coming in. I'll pour my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your old men shall dream dreams, and your young men shall see visions. And also upon the servants and upon the handmaids in those days, not of the past, in those days, the days coming, I will pour out my spirit. That's the promise. And it's a promise that was fulfilled in Acts of the Apostles chapter 2. It wasn't fulfilled in Matthew. They were still looking forward to it. You won't find it fulfilled, pouring out the Spirit upon all flesh in Mark. Because it has to be after Matthew, after Mark, after Luke, after John. It has to be after the sacrifice of Jesus Christ. It has to be after Jesus Christ has established the new covenant and has shed his blood. That's why you come to Acts of the Apostles chapter 2. Acts of the Apostles chapter 2 in verse 1. And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were expecting that day. This is going to be your day. Somebody there said, this is going to be your day. And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. Afterward, afterward, something had taken place. All that argument was gone. All the debate was gone. All the infighting was gone. All the place seeking, who will be the greatest among us, all that was gone. They were with one accord in one place. Father, sanctify them, that they all may be one, as you and I are one. I in them and thou in me, that they may be made perfect in one, that the world may believe that thou hast sent me. It says now that day has come. They were saved. That day has come. They were sanctified. And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. And suddenly, there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind. And then it goes on to say, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. They were even sitting down. This is not an emotional scene. This is not something that, you know, goes with just shouting alone. They were sitting down, but it was one accord. They were sitting down, but they were expectant. They were sitting down, but they were praying. They were sitting down, and they were holding on to the promise of the Lord. And there appeared unto them cloven tongues like as of fire. And it sat upon each of them. Each of them. There were men there. Each of them. There were women there. Each of them. And then he goes on to say, and they were all filled, all filled, all filled with the Holy Ghost, and began to speak with other tongues, languages, as the Spirit gave them utterance. The Spirit came in, and the Spirit gave them utterance. The point is this now, verse 16. But this is that which was spoken by the prophet Joel. And it shall come to pass in the last days. Afterwards. In the last days. Not in the former days. That means that the Holy Ghost was given after Jesus Christ established the covenant for the last days. Says God, I will pour out of my Spirit upon all flesh. And your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. And your young men shall see visions. And your old men shall dream dreams. Now you understand that when the Holy Ghost comes, the promise had been given. And that promise, it tells us, when the Holy Ghost comes, you will see by the manifestation of that Holy Ghost. You see, there are people, they talk about the Holy Ghost. And they think that the coming of the Holy Ghost only makes them to act a particular way or say some things particular way. And they begin to repeat those things over and over. Look at this. When the Holy Ghost comes, the young men will see the vision, the heavenly vision. Paul the apostle said, I was not disobedient to the heavenly vision. There are people that only see earthly realities, material things. When the Holy Ghost comes, it's going to bring the heavenly vision. Your old men shall dream dreams. That is, they'll have something painted in their heart. And they will see the dream of riches beyond. And they will see, we can still capture that for the Lord. Like Joseph was a dreamer. They will not be in ignorance. It will not be that, well, now we're old and gray-headed. And because of that, there are no dreams anymore. And then it says, even the daughters will prophesy. And the sons will prophesy. They will proclaim the goodness of the Lord and the greatness of the Lord. When the Holy Ghost comes, it's not just that you will shake. It's not just that you will howl. You will shout. All these things will be there. And then it says in verse 18, and on my servants and on my handmaidens, I will pour out in those days of my Spirit, and they shall prophesy. And then he tells us in verse 38, then Peter said unto them, repent and be baptized every one of you in the name of Jesus for the remission of sin. First, you will go through the water baptism. First, a conversion will take place. And then you are baptized into the name of Jesus. A consecration, a full surrender unto Jesus Christ, a total separation from the world, and a total complete surrender and affiliation with Christ. Baptize into the name of Jesus, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost, for the promise is unto you. You're saved, for the promise is unto you. You're born again, for the promise is unto you. And you're regenerated, a new life has come in you, for the promise is unto you. You have been baptized into Christ, immersed into Christ, and you have been baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. And everything you do, everywhere you go, is done to the glory of Jesus. Then the promise is unto you. You're sanctified, you're made holy, you're made ready for the coming in of the Holy Ghost. The promise is unto you and to your children and to all that are far off, even as many as the Lord our God shall call. The promise. Luke chapter 24 and in verse 49. Luke chapter 24 verse 49. Here the Lord is telling us, look at this in verse 49. And behold, I send the promise of my Father upon you. Jesus promised the experience, and the Father promised the experience. Behold, I send the promise of my Father upon you. They were to look to the Father. They were to look to the Heavenly Father. Because this promise is coming from the Father. They were to look unto the Lord Jesus. Because I will baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire. It says, and behold, I send the promise of my Father upon you. And then he goes to tell us, but tarry ye in the city of Jerusalem until ye be endued with power from on high. Not power from below. Not power from the river, not power from the evil spirit, not power from occultism, power from above, power from on high. And because this is what the Father has promised, we ask the Father. Luke chapter 11. Luke chapter 11. And we're reading here about the prayer we pray, praying to the Father. Verse 9, and I say unto you, ask and shall be given you. Seek and ye shall find. Knock and it shall be opened unto you. For everyone, no exception, everyone that asketh receiveth, and he that seeketh findeth, and to him that knocketh it shall be opened. If a son shall ask bread of any of you that's a father, will he give him a stone? Or if he ask a fish, will he give him for a fish, give him a serpent? Or if he ask an egg, will he offer him a scorpion? If ye then, being evil, naturally evil, if ye then, being evil, born in sin, conceived in sin, if ye then, being evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more readily shall your Heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to them that ask him. And because you know that this is the promise coming from the Father, that's why you ask him and you have the confidence he will definitely answer. He will answer us in Jesus' name. Now the presence of the Spirit. The presence of the Spirit. We need to understand that those who are baptized in the Holy Ghost, they are not strangers to the Holy Ghost. Think about this. Those who are baptized in water are not strangers to water. Before you are baptized in water, and before you are immersed in water, already you have taken the water, you have taken some water in. Already you are born of water and of the Spirit. Because except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. Before you are baptized in water, the water of the word has already come to cleanse you, has already come to wash you, and you are clean. It says, I will sprinkle clean water upon them, and they shall be clean. From all their filthiness will I cleanse them. It is after that water has been applied, you now go for water baptism. And so, when you are going for the water baptism, you are not a stranger to the water, spiritual, to the water that comes from on high, to the water of the word of God. The same thing, you are to be baptized in the Holy Ghost, baptized in the Holy Spirit. You are not a stranger to the Holy Spirit. Number one, you are born of water and of the Spirit. Number two, you are already having the fruit of the Spirit. You're not a stranger to him at all. Number three, the Spirit of God is already bearing witness in your heart that you are a child of God. And if the Spirit that raised up Jesus from the dead dwell in your mortal body, he that raised Jesus from the dead will quicken your mortal body. You're not a stranger to him at all. The presence of the Spirit. You see, he's been present from the time of salvation. He now wants to become prominent and preeminent in your life in the power, endowment of power by the Holy Ghost. Look at Galatians chapter 5. Galatians chapter 5, we're not talking of people that just come in and they're strangers to the Holy Ghost. They have never heard of the Holy Ghost and they have never seen any manifestation of the Holy Ghost in their lives. It says, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such, there is no law. Already you have salvation. Already you have the fruit of the Spirit. Romans chapter 8. Romans chapter 8. You are born again. The Spirit of God has been there. Romans chapter 8. And we're reading from verse 11. From verse 14. Romans chapter 8 from verse 14. It says, for as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. Already you have been led by the Spirit of God. Verse 15, for ye have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear, but ye have received the spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Father. That word Abba is like your newborn baby that's calling daddy, daddy, mommy, mommy. Because it says, now the Spirit of God is in your heart, crying, Abba, Father, Daddy, Father. And the Spirit himself beareth witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. You're not a stranger to the Spirit of God. If you are born again, he bears witness in your heart before he comes in and becomes preeminent. We're looking at John chapter 14. John chapter 14, verse 17. Even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it seeth him not, neither knoweth him, but ye know him, for he dwelleth with you. Not that he will dwell with you, even now, he dwelleth with you. You are saved, he dwelleth with you. You are sanctified, he dwelleth with you. You are cleansed by the washing of water by the word. It says, he dwelleth with you. Already is present with you. But look at this, verse 17, and shall be in you. There is a present experience of the Holy Spirit. Already you are born again. A present experience of the Holy Spirit that you are sanctified. There is a future experience, something still to come. He shall be in you. That tells us then that already you have that Holy Spirit in a measure. You have his presence in a measure, but now it's going to be upon you and within you in a greater measure. the presence of the Holy Spirit. And when he comes in the Spirit baptism, you're immersed in the Spirit. You are plunged into the Spirit. And you have that power of the Spirit. Then he comes with other things that will be present real in your life. We're looking at John chapter 16, verses 12 and 13. I have yet many things to say unto you. I've been present with you. I've said a lot of things to you. You think you know it all. And you think you have it all. But I still have many things to say unto you. But cannot bear, you cannot bear them now. When the Holy Ghost comes, he gives you capacity, a larger capacity, a deeper capacity, a higher understanding, and a higher capacity to bear all that he will reveal unto you. How be it? Verse 13. When he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you into all truth. Everything I would have told you, I know them, but I've not told you because you cannot bear them now. The Holy Ghost is coming, and in a greater presence and with greater power, he will guide you into all truth, for he shall not speak of himself. But whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak, and he will show you things to come. Chapter 14, verse 26. John 14, verse 26. But the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things. You see, when the Holy Ghost comes, it's not just, yes, you speak in tongues, but it's not just speaking in tongues. He will teach you all things. And you know, there are people that profess to have Holy Ghost, Holy Ghost, Holy Ghost. They don't know the doctrines of the Bible. And they do not understand the word of God. And when they read the Bible, it's like they're confused. They don't have the Holy Ghost according to the word of Jesus. The words of Jesus is, when he, the Holy Ghost, has come, he will teach you all things. Already we have read, he will guide you into all truth. You'll not be dabbling into false doctrine. I was confused. I didn't understand. I didn't know it was false doctrine. You'll not be going to a place that they say they are offering prayer and they are using the power of occultism. And you are there, you didn't know. And you say you have the Holy Ghost. The Holy Ghost within you will detect and say, that's the spirit of error. You cannot be there. The Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things and bring all things to your remembrance. There are people who say they have the Holy Ghost. They can't remember the scripture. They cannot remember the messages they are hearing. And when temptation comes, when trial comes, they cannot remember the word that will push them over and make them victorious. When you have the Holy Ghost, it will bring all things to your remembrance whatsoever I have said unto you. The Holy Ghost in his presence brings comfort. He's a comforter. He brings counsel. He's the one that will guide you. He brings boldness. He brings guidance. He brings holiness. He's the Holy Ghost. He brings fire, passion, and zeal. He'll baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire. He brings power. You shall receive power when that Holy Ghost comes upon you. He brings vision. You will see the heavenly vision. The promise of the Spirit. And then we have the presence of the Spirit. Now the power of the Spirit. The power has come. I say the power has come. The power of the Spirit. You know what? When you have the power, something will change in that your body, in that your life, and in that your family. You will go around with the power of the Holy Ghost. And this morning, it's coming. I said this morning, it's coming. Look at Acts chapter 1 verse 8. But ye shall receive power. But ye shall receive power. I've been saved, and I don't understand what's happening to me. When the Holy Ghost comes, you'll understand something great will happen to you. But ye shall have power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me. That means you will testify. You will preach to other people. You will touch the lives of other people. It will not be that, you know, I'm there, but, you know, I'm afraid to talk to them. There'll be fire inside you. You will not be able to keep quiet or to contain. You'll be witnesses to me both in Jerusalem and in Judea and in Samaria and unto the uttermost part of the earth. Look at Micah chapter 3. Micah chapter 3. We're reading from verse 8. Micah chapter 3. Reading from verse 8. And you'll see what the Holy Ghost does when he comes in. In verse 8. But truly, I am full of power by the Spirit of the Lord, and of judgment and of might. And then it says, to declare to Jacob his transgression and to Israel his sin. It says, I am full of power by the Spirit of the Lord. You know, there are people, they see things happening around them. Maybe they are leaders, maybe they are preachers. And they always say, well, I don't have the courage. I don't have the boldness to confront them. People around them are living in open sin. People around them are living and doing evil with impunity. They say, well, they'll take care of themselves. I don't know what to say. I don't want to say anything. I don't want to get into trouble, because they don't have the power of the Holy Ghost. Boldness will come into you. Might and strength will come into you. The fire will be burning in your soul, and the zeal of the Lord will consume you. You will not be able to stay around the places where there is sin, where there is evil, and you cannot open your mouth. When you are baptized, immersed in the Holy Ghost, you'll be able to say above or beyond what Micah has said, truly, I am full of power by the Spirit of the Lord, and as of judgment, of might, to declare unto Jacob, to declare to the nation his transgression, and to Israel his sin. I'm sure you know that in our nation, our country, there are people that say they have the Holy Ghost. They are Pentecostals. And they cannot tell the politicians when they meet them. They cannot tell them that this is not right. And they might even go to all these meetings, all these politicians, when they're looking for votes. And the people, they know their sin. They know their evil. It will take somebody else to come who does not profess to have, you know, the power, the baptism in the Holy Ghost, to tell the people their sin and to say, this is not right. But we preachers cannot say it. We pastors cannot say it. Even in our local church, we cannot confront evil. But when the Holy Ghost comes in his power, you'll confront evil. You'll not be using earthly wisdom and saying, you know, we're using, with all the wisdom we're using, the people continue in their evil. You're full of the Holy Ghost today. You'll challenge evil anywhere you find evil. And when you challenge them, you lead them to repentance, to confession, and the forsaking of their sin. That time has now come. I said that time has now come. In your office, you will not keep quiet. Anywhere you are, you'll not keep quiet. Evil will not just be taking the throne and then reigning. And then you are there as a child of God and you cannot say anything. We're going to pray this morning, the power of the Holy Ghost will come upon your life. And when the power of the Holy Ghost comes upon your life, fearlessness will come into you. Boldness will come into you. The authority and power of the Holy Ghost will come upon you. And anywhere there is evil, even before you open your mouth, your very presence will drive away that evil in Jesus' name. Your environment will be clean. Your surrounding will be clean. And the fire of the Holy Ghost all around you will burn every evil away from your surrounding in Jesus' name. In Acts of the Apostles chapter 4. Acts of the Apostles chapter 4. And we're reading here from verse 31. Acts chapter 4, reading from verse 31. And when they had prayed, are you ready to pray this morning? I said, are you ready to pray this morning? And when they had prayed, the place was shaking where they were assembled together. And they were all filled. And they were all filled. Help me shout it out. And they were all filled. I'm waiting for you. And they were all filled. I want to hear your voice. Go on, read everything. And they were all filled. Can you say that? With the Holy Ghost. And they spake the word of God with boldness. Look at verse 33. And with great power gave the apostles witness of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus. And great grace was upon them all. Great grace upon them all. This morning, you're going to ask, you're going to pray, and the Holy Ghost will come in that baptismal measure in Jesus' name. Weakness will vanish away. Fainting will vanish away. The fear of man will vanish away. The boldness and courage of the Spirit will come upon your life in Jesus' name. You see, those apostles and those disciples, they prayed. They didn't say, already we have been sent out two by two. I will preach the word to people. And many people came to know the Lord. And many people were healed. They knew they needed more. And they came for more. And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord sanctified in one place. And then when they were sitting, when they prayed, the Holy Ghost came upon them. Your own time has come. I said, your own time has come. Has thou not known? Has thou not heard that the everlasting God, the Lord, the creator of the ends of the earth, fainteth not, neither is weary? There is no searching of his understanding. That's telling us that there's no searching of what God will do today. Isaiah chapter 40 verse 28. Has thou not heard? Has thou not known? Are you not hearing today? Don't you know today that the everlasting God, the Lord, is the one who has promised the Holy Ghost and is the creator of the ends of the earth. He faints not, neither is weary. There is no searching of his understanding. He giveth power. Today is your day. He giveth power. This is your time. He giveth power to the faint, and to them that have no might, he increases strength. It will increase your strength. You will not be the same again. After that Holy Ghost comes upon you, even the youth shall faint and be weary, and the young men shall utterly fall. But they that wait upon the Lord, they that wait upon the Lord, who are these people? They that wait upon the Lord, where are these people? They that wait upon the Lord, do you know their name? They that wait upon the Lord, have you come across them? They that wait upon the Lord, the people that say, I will not let you go today, I'm going to be immersed inside that Holy Ghost, empowered by the Holy Ghost, energized by the Holy Ghost. I will not stop until this power from on high comes upon my life. And they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. Somebody is getting renewed there today, empowered there today, immersed in fire here today. Every chaff will burn away, and they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagle. Your time has come. I said, your time has come. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. Mountains will not disturb you anymore. You will fly over. The rivers will not disturb you anymore. You will fly over. All those flying spirits will not disturb you anymore. You will fly higher than them. All those powers will not hinder you anymore. It says they shall mount up. They shall mount up. I'm going up. I said I'm going up. I said I'm going up. Somebody there, I am going up. Somebody there, I am going up. They shall mount up with wings as eagle. They shall run, they shall run, they shall run, they shall run and not be weary. And they shall walk and they shall not faint. They shall walk and they shall not faint. They shall walk and they shall not. Where are they? Where are they? Where are they? The people that shall not faint. The people that will be empowered. The people that will be energized. Where are they today? The people that wait upon the Lord. And the people that renew their strength. Where are they today? The people that will mount up with wings as eagles. The people walking. The people running. The people doing the work of the Lord. They'll not be weary. They'll not be tired. Your day has come. He will pour upon you the power of the Holy Ghost.